I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up, rise up, rise up.
Welcome once again to the Midnight Ride. My name is David Carrico, and I am here in the Puritan Barn in the Now You See TV studios with my co-host John Pounders, and once again, we're going to go on the Midnight Ride. Tonight, a classic Midnight Ride. Gog from Tartaria rising from Jubilees 10, World War III. Tonight, we're going to show you the reuniting of the ancient warlords of Tartaria, the release points upon this earth when the restrainer will be removed, some absolutely remarkable things. So get ready. The ride starts right now because we are now
live, live, live. What's up, guys? It's so good to be able to say those words once again. It's good to be in here with you, David. How has your week been?
It's been fantastic. Amazing things are happening. God's answering prayer. It's just exciting. I can honestly say I'm excited about what God's doing. And some of the things we're going to be sharing with you tonight of things that are beginning to open up that we're going to be saying a lot more about. It's just an exciting time to be working in the kingdom.
I agree. And tonight, you guys, let us know where you guys are from. If you're in the live chat right now, congratulations. You found us live. There's a lot of people in there chatting. Feel free to come in there. All the rules we have is be respectful and enjoy your time together with fellowship. So we're thankful. Let us know where you're at. Even if you're listening after the fact, let us know in the comments where you're from. We love to hear about our remnant all over the world. And we're super excited. Tonight we want to give a shout out to our sponsors, Joshua Watts Leather Company. A longtime sponsor, has made so many things for a lot of you guys out there. Just so talented. If you check out his website's in the link below. Also, Sugar and Spice Soap Company. They will have you feeling fresh without having to worry about pig fat being rubbed all over your body or toxins or anything for that matter. All natural substances, and just they do an awesome job. Beautiful soaps and lotions and such. And so we're super excited to have them as a sponsor as well. Links are in the description as well. With that being said, David, let's get this ride going.
All right, we're going to hammer down tonight. We have a lot of stuff to cover, and we're going to begin in the passage in the 38th chapter of Ezekiel about Gog, and we're going to understand just exactly who and what Gog is. Ezekiel 38, and the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him. A prophecy against Gog. Well, Gog here is identified as the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal. That's a people group, and also over a land area, the land of Magog. Now, we need to understand what a prince is, and we see that in Scripture. Whenever we want to find biblical answers, the best way you can do is let Scripture interpret Scripture. In Daniel chapter 10 and verse 13, But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. Just like there is a dark principality over the land area of Persia, Gog is the prince over the land of Magog. In Daniel chapter 10, verses 20 and 21, Then said he, Knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I am gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. And I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, that there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael, your prince. And we've had Michael mentioned twice in these scriptures here in Daniel. And we see that there are good princes and that there are bad princes, and that the good princes hold back the bad princes, and that there are principalities and powers over different land masses. So we're going to be looking at the dark principality over the land of Magog. Now, in this text here in Daniel 10:21, the word holdeth, if you would look that up in your Strong's Concordance, it's number 2388, it means to seize, to bind, restrain. Now, this is the restrainer, and you can see here very clearly the restrainer at work. And a lot of people in the pre-trib camp, and all of them in the pre-trib camp, they tell you that the restrainer is the Holy Spirit, and that the Holy Spirit will soon be taken out of the world. Well, the restrainer is clearly Michael and the angels. And when the good angels stand down, the bad angels are going to run amok. Now, let's look at it in some scriptures in Ezekiel, and you can in Enoch. And do you have the scriptures there in Enoch, John?
Yeah, is it not over there?
They did not. The scriptures in Enoch did not come up.
Okay, I'll pull it out for you. I'll just read them for you. Enoch 10:11 is
the first 10
one.
And 11 and 10:15.
Okay. It says, and the Lord said unto Michael, go bind Semyaza and his associates who have united themselves with women so as to have defiled themselves with them in all their uncleanliness.
And we can see the restrainer there. It's Michael that binds. And Enoch 10:15, and I will destroy all the spirits of the reprobate and the children of the watchers. And we can see here clearly what the restrainer is. The restrainer is Michael and the other angels. We see it in the book of Daniel, holding them back. We see it in the book of Enoch, binding and restraining. And in Daniel 12:1, it says, and at that time shall Michael stand up, the great prince which standeth for the children of thy people, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book. And that word in the Hebrew, Michael shall stand up, that's the Hebrew word amad, and it means to stand up and to stand still. This is the same time when there is silence in heaven, and the awesome time when Michael stands down and there's the removal of the restrainer and these spirits are going to be released. Now, this is something, it's amazing, but we're actually going to be able to show you some precise places where the spirits from the underworld are going to be released. It's just amazing. But in Genesis chapter 10, verse 1 and 2, and it says in Ezekiel 38 that Gog is the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. Well, let's find out who they are in Genesis 10. These are the generations of the sons of Noah, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, and unto them were sons born after the flood. The sons of Japheth, Gomer, and Magog, and Madai, and Javan, and Tubal, and Meshech, and Tyrus. Now, we see here in the Table of Nations in Genesis 10 that Meshech and Tubal are the grandchildren of Noah. Now, this is going to open up the understanding as we go to the 10th chapter of the book of Jubilees, and we're going to understand just exactly in what way that Gog is the chief prince over Meshech and Tubal. Now let's read in Jubilees chapter 10. And in the third week of this Jubilee, the unclean demons began to lead astray the children of the sons of Noah. And and to make to err and destroy them. And the sons of Noah came to Noah their father, and they told him concerning the demons which were leading astray and blinding and slaying his sons' sons. Now, who are Noah's sons' sons? Those are Noah's grandchildren. And this is exactly the time when Gog was the chief prince over Meshech and Tubal. He was the dark entity over this landmass. And at the time of Noah's grandchildren, they were absolutely clobbering them. And it goes on to say, and he prayed before the Lord his God and said, God of the spirits of all flesh, who has shown mercy unto me and has saved me and my sons from the waters of the flood, and has not caused me to perish as thou didst the sons of perdition, for thy grace has been great towards me, and great has been thy mercy to my soul. Let thy grace be lift up upon my sons, and let not wicked spirits rule over them, lest they should destroy them from the earth. And I was reading this commentary on the book of Jubilees by James Vanderkam, and this is when the dots really begin to connect for me. And he said this, and this helps put it in a time frame, and it really opens up some understanding here. He says the book presents a new episode about Noah's grandchildren, one that happened some 15 years or so after the division of the earth. So we're about 15 years after Pangaea here, or so after the division of the earth, and before Noah's descendants started the trek toward their lands to travel to the different regions to repopulate the earth, like he said. So we're 15 years after Pangaea. Gog is clobbering Noah's grandchildren, Meshech and Tubal, to where they cannot move out and fulfill repopulating the earth as the Lord commanded them. Now, here is a huge revelation. In Jubilees chapter 10, verse 8 and 9, there is an entity mentioned called Mastema. And when you compare the book of Ezekiel with the book of Jubilees, we can see clearly that Gog is Mastema. In Jubilees 10, verse 8 and 9, and the chief of the spirits, Mastema. And see, the chief, he is the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. And now we see the chief of the spirits of this area, Mastema, same entity, came and said, Lord Creator, let some of them remain before me, and let them hearken to my voice, and do all that I shall say unto them. For if some of them are not left to me, I shall not be able to execute the power of my will on the sons of men. For these are for corruption and leading astray before my judgment. For great is the wickedness of the sons of men. And he said, let the tenth part of them remain before him, and let nine parts descend into the place of condemnation. So we have an amazing episode here where we have the description in the book of Jubilees of the chief of the spirits slaughtering the grandchildren, or not slaughtering, but absolutely pounding Noah's grandchildren. In Ezekiel 38, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal is Gog. We have the same entity. And when we can make this identification, it's going to open up the scenario that's going to go forward, that's going to give us a keen insight into how the ancient warlords of Tartaria are being reunited right before our eyes. In the Word Biblical Commentary, it says this, about the passage in Ezekiel 38. And when we study Daniel 11, which is about the willful king, much of Daniel 11 directly applies to Antiochus Epiphanes, who fulfilled to small detail many of the events in Daniel 11. And yet there were events that yet look forward to a future time when there will be a final beast rise from the sea. In Revelation 13. The same is true in Ezekiel 38 with Gog. Gog is prophesied to return. And at the same time, Gog is a spiritual dark entity. And at the same time, there was a historical figure that actually fulfilled many of the components of Ezekiel 38 and 39 in the 7th, 6th, and 7th century BC. And I'll read from the Word Biblical Commentary. It says, the name seems to relate to one known to the Greeks as Gyges and to the Assyrians as Gugu, who was a powerful king in Lydia in West Asia Minor in the first half of the 7th century BC. As with the national name, so here a great figure of the past is evidently used to define a future threat, as we might speak fearfully of a new Hitler. And this Gog is literally going to be Hitler on steroids, if you will. He is going to be, the description there in the Word Biblical Commentary is so appropriate, and we're going to be looking at the historical Gog, or Gyges, from the 7th century BC, and we're going to really, hopefully, make it understandable here. Now, in Lang's Biblical Commentary, do you have anything you wanted to say, John, before I...
No, man, I'm just listening. I'll be up with something to say in a minute, I'm sure. I'm just right now just loving what you're pulling out, because I've never connected that personally, so it's really cool to hear.
Well, here's a huge one, right here, in Lang's Biblical Commentary. And he says, already Josephus, and doubtless in accordance with generally received tradition, recognizes in them the Scythians, and he's talking about the land of Magog. Now, the Scythians lived in the area to the north and east of the Black Sea, in the area of the Caucasus Mountains. This is the area where the word Caucasian comes from. And I hate to beat up on the white people. They're getting a bad rap here lately, but it is what it is. And this is the area that we're of Tartaria, and where Gog is going to rise. Now, this is what's amazing. It says, the Tartaric and Turkish Kok, or Khan, is the word for a traveler and a Tartaric chief of the 13th century, Gog or Khan. Gog denotes, well, and it says, I'll read this in a second, but the very word Gog was used for the Tartar war chiefs. Mm. If you would have saw the Big Daddy leading the Tartar warriors, he would have been called Gog. It says that it denotes him who sets himself like the roof in the midst between heaven and earth, between God and men. And this guy, just like it said in the Word Biblical Commentary, he is going to be Hitler on steroids. He is going to come from this spiritual heritage and this landmass of the ancient Tartarian warlords. He is going to be Hitler, Genghis Khan, and everything bad and nasty all rolled in to one little package.
One thing I will point out, interestingly, just because I think we've talked about this before, but one of the sons' names, excuse me, Meshach, in a lot of the etymologies and stuff that I read about Moscow, was where they get the term Moscow from, Russia, which is really interesting. I remember when we did one of our shows on Tartaria, we talked about that. And Tartaria is interesting because you did bring up Tartaria just a second ago. I don't know if anybody caught that, but Tartaria is one of those things that has been hidden from history for a period of time for some reason or another. And now it's being brought back out, and we've done our part in trying to bring it back out. And then now we're connecting it through biblical prophecy and Bible things, because really all other connections kind of lead down a rabbit trail that kind of leads you almost nowhere. And so thankfully this is what you're doing tonight. So I'm really excited about this. So if you guys are waiting to hear more about Tartaria, this is definitely something you need to listen to.
Yeah. And the very name Gog, it's amazing, but this is what you would call the Tartarian warlords. You would call him Gog very respectfully. Now, Gyges, who was the historical king from the dynasty of Lydian kings, he reigned 687 to 652 BC, and his name means Candales, the dog strangler. And this was the title that was given to the Greek god Hermes. It goes on to say that it was by an appeal to the Oracle of Delphi and the confirmation of the right of Gyges to the crown of the Delphian god. And this Oracle of Delphi was a woman prophetess, and she prophesied that Gyges should be the king. And here we see the same relationship. It's the false prophet that causes all of the world to worship the first beast in Revelation 13. So we see this Gyges as a perfect picture of the beast of Revelation chapter 13, just as we did in Antiochus Epiphanes. Now, also from the 1911 Britannica, Gyges was also known as O Gyges. And it says in the Britannica, in Greek mythology, the first king of Thebes. During his reign, a great flood called the Ogygian Deluge was said to have overwhelmed the land. Similar legends were current in Attica and Phrygia. Ogyges is variously described as a Bohetian Autochthon, as the son of Cadmus or of Poseidon. And Gyges was known and was believed to be one of the Titans, the very son of Poseidon himself, according to some legends. And we talked about this in a previous Midnight Ride on Tartaria, and he reigned in the area that we would now know as Greece, and it was called the Flood of Ogyges, or the Flood of Deucalion. And this flood literally went up from Greece into the very area of Magog, of the land of the there where the Scythians were, by the Caucasian mountains, and went to the east. And this is exactly where the ancient land of Tartaria was. If you would go to the there in the area, just to the north and east of the Black and Caspian Seas, there in the Caucasian mountains, it would extend all the way to the east to China. And what we're seeing today is the actual reuniting. We're now seeing the cooperation between Russia and between China, and we're going to have the reuniting of these ancient Tartarian warlords. And when Gog rises, we're going to see World War III. We're absolutely going to see it. And what we're seeing tonight is the spiritual understanding that is going to help us to recognize what is going on, not only in the physical, but also in the spiritual. Now, in the book of Enoch, chapter 54 and verse 5, and he said unto me, these are being prepared for the host of Azazel, so that they may take them and cast them into the abyss of complete condemnation, and they shall cover their jaws with rough stones, as the Lord of spirits commanded. And in 56:5, these are coming back. You see, we're going to have the return of the 200. We're going to have the return of all of these spirits when the restrainer is removed. And in Enoch 56:5, it says, and in those days the angels shall return. They're going to come back and hurl themselves to the east upon the Parthians and Medes, and they shall stir up the king so that a spirit of unrest shall come upon them, and they shall rouse them from their thrones, that they may break forth as lions from their lairs, as hungry wolves among their flocks. And we've talked about this previously also, how that the Daniel 11, Enoch 56 invasion of the willful king from Persia into Israel is going to be the catalyst of World War III. And this is absolutely the release of the Spirit that is going to trigger this whole thing. Now, it's a very easy identification. In Ezekiel chapter 38 and verse 15, "And thou shalt come from thy place out of the north parts, and thou and many people with thee, all of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army." Now, in this map, I mean, it is what it is. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. If you look at Israel, straight north, we've got the Ukraine. Has anyone seen anything going on in the Ukraine lately? We all know that right now, Putin is amassing a massive amount of troops ready to invade the Ukraine. And right there is where the flood of Ogyges went. It went right up from Greece and right on over. And that's where the ancient kingdom of Tartaria was. And Gog, I have to believe that Gog is now rising, because we're seeing the reuniting of these ancient Tartarian warlords, and they're going to come from the north down into Israel. We've seen it in Ezekiel 56, Daniel 11, and this is just a more comprehensive view into what's going on in the spiritual realm and to some of the specifics. We're seeing this happen right now before our eyes. In Ezekiel 38 and 4, we're going to see another key identification that's going to help us to understand just exactly what's going on here. In Ezekiel 38 and 4, "And I will turn thee back and put hooks in thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth, and all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords." Now, does that language sound familiar to any of you Bible readers? "I will put hooks into thy jaws." And this is the exact language that we see in the book of Job describing Leviathan in Job 41, verse 1 and 2. "Canst thou draw out Leviathan with the hook, or his tongue with the cord which thou lettest down? Canst thou put an hook into his nose, or bore his jaw through with a thorn?" And evidently, Gog was an entity that was able to inhabit Leviathan, just like we see Satan inhabiting the serpent. And in Isaiah 21, Leviathan is called a serpent two times. Now, there's no doubt what Leviathan looks like. Now, here we get a definite connection between Gog and the serpent. And this is the connection that's going to be able to give us the ability to identify where these things are going to come up from. In Job 41, verses 15 through 22. Do you want to read that text for us, John?
Sure. It says, starting in verse 15, "His scales are his pride, shut up together as with a closed seal. One is so near to the other that no air can come between them. They are joined one to another. They stick together that they cannot be sundered. By his kneesing a light doth shine, and his eyes are like the eyelids of the morning. Out of his mouth go burning lamps, and sparks of fire leap out. Out of his nostrils goeth smoke, as out of seething pot or cauldron. His breath kindleth coals, and a flame goeth out of his mouth. In his neck remaineth strength, and sorrow is turned into joy before him."
And in the book of Isaiah, and what we got here, we've got a sea dragon. We got a sea monster is what we got. There's no doubt about it. We've got a big serpent, or dragon, if you will. And in Isaiah chapter 27 and verse 1, it says, "In that day the Lord with his sore and great and strong sword shall punish Leviathan, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, that crooked serpent, and he shall slay the dragon that is in the sea." And of course, Satan was called the dragon in the book of Genesis. Satan was inside the serpent, and evidently Gog had that same capacity to inhabit this serpent. And we see that these serpents, this is the signature of Gog that will soon return. Now, this is a slide of the serpent mound over in southern Ohio. And we see here the pictures of it. It's a huge thing, and it twists around with opening jaws. You know, it talks about the jaws in Ezekiel 38 and Job 41, and you can sure see the jaws on this thing, that the mouth is open, swallowing the world, if you will. And in this book here, well, and look here in Ezekiel 38 and 8, it says, "And after many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come into the land that is brought back from the sword and is gathered out of many people against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but it is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them." So Gog will be visited. And Gog is going to return, just like the book of Enoch says that the 200 are coming back, and Gog could very well be one of these 200, maybe even Azazel himself, I don't know. But Gog is going to be visited, and Gog is going to return. Now, I want to read something that I got chills when I read this in this book by Graham Hancock, called America Before. And Graham Hancock is not a Christian, but he is a fantastic researcher. And in this book, Mr. Hancock says this, and he is there at the Serpent Mound when he is writing this. He says, "People beside it appear as midgets or elves in the shadow of a dragon. And for the first time, with the shiver down my spine, I became aware, not in my intellect, but in my heart, in my spirit, that a mighty and uncanny power slumbers here." And I so agree with him. I believe that there is definitely a spirit slumbering in this serpent mound. And we're going to show you that there are several of these serpent mounds all over the world. And these are going to be release points for Gog and his minions, and some of them are not too far from us right here. He goes on to say, the guide that was with him, he said, "Ross seems to read my mind. Some call it Manitou," he says, "but I'd go further. I'd say our serpent is Gitche Manitou, the great spirit and ancestral guardian of the ancient people." And he goes on to talk about the legends of the Cherokee Indians. And the Cherokee Indians, they believed that there is a giant crystal buried in the head of the serpent at the Serpent Mound. But I believe absolutely that Graham Hancock is right, that there's going to be something slumbering there that's going to be coming out before too long. And the Serpent Mound, if you ever see the one in Ohio, it is very, very impressive. It is huge. But there is underneath in the cliff, and it didn't come, the picture, I don't have it here. Do you have the picture up over here? Yeah.
Yes, yep.
There it is, to where they can see it. And underneath the Serpent Mound, and let me go back. Let's go back to this other slide of the Serpent Mound.
Okay.
And we'll try to explain just what we have here.
Well, one of the pictures that I have there of the Serpent Mound, you can kind of see it.
Yeah.
The middle picture there.
Yeah.
Where the mouth comes out. It looks like a rock face out here in front of the egg there. Oops, went the wrong way here. Right there. And so this, you guys can't see my mouse, but this piece in that middle picture, that rock face, is what we're looking at over here.
And what we're going to see is that this earth Serpent Mound is sitting on top of a huge stone serpent. And here is what the face looks like. This is the face of the serpent on the end of this cliff. It is unmistakable. And the Indian legends of the Cherokee, they say that this is the very face of the Gitche Manitou. And of course, this serpent worship, it was all through South America. He was worshipped there as Quetzalcoatl. America was the land of the flying serpent. And boy, we can see that. And this, and you're talking about, you know, they say the serpent mound, the earth part, goes back to 2000 BC. And it's probably even older than that. We're looking at something here that is antediluvian. This is something that is very ancient. It is just absolutely chilling to think how long this has been there. This was in existence at the time when Mastema, a.k.a. Gog, was pounding the fire out of Noah's grandchildren. This was over there as an ancient pagan worship site of the serpent. We have something here that goes back into the very heart of antiquity and to the very ground zero of what Satan is going to do. And we see here something that is going to be a place, just like Graham Hancock said, that he believes something slumbers there. I believe with all of my heart that he is indeed right.
Yeah, I remember going there and flying a drone over the spot and seeking the spot out and just looking at it. You know, you see how it lines up with the different solstices, the head, all of the different places line up with the constellation Draco. And there's definitely, I can't say that I got like a weird feeling there, but there was definitely a quietness there that was different. You know, there was something about that place. I mean, talk about, you couldn't see more of an outline of a serpent. I mean, there's no reaching for that when it comes to the serpent mounds in Ohio. It's beyond, beyond interesting, to say the least. If you've never been there, I'm not so sure that I would suggest you go there. But if you're a history person or you like to look at archaeology, look at that. That's definitely one of the places to go on the checklist just to see it. You know, it's huge.
It is. And the last time I was there, I wasn't aware of the stone serpent face.
Yeah.
And I would like to go back and get a better look and some pictures of that. Now, there's another serpent mound, and the biggest one, well, guess where? It's in Bashan, which Og, the king of Bashan, he was the last of the remnant of the Rephaim. And here's a picture of it. And you can see the serpent formation there. And this is made out of basalt, out of lava flow. And it is several times larger than the one in Ohio, which is huge. And in this one, there are burial chambers on the top of this. And it is just absolutely amazing. And it is only about a quarter of a mile from the area from where we have Gilgal Rephaim. And there's another one here, and this is the Avonbury Hinge, and there's a serpent mound, and there's a hinge, and always we see that. We see the serpent in Ohio opening its mouth and its jaws to swallow the circle or the hinge. We see it here in Avonbury. There's another one. Just since I prepared this presentation, there's another serpent mound in Burlington, Wisconsin. And there's another one. We're not going to give you the exact location, but we have discovered another serpent mound very near to us. And we're going to have a mystery guest very soon that's going to come on the Midnight Ride and explain it to you. So we have the Avonbury Hinge and the serpent mound. We have the one in Israel, the serpent mound of Bashan. We have the one in Ohio. There's one in Burlington, Wisconsin. And these are literally going to be release points where we're going to see these serpents released when the restrainer is removed. Now, John, do you have the picture from of the serpent mound from...
It's actually, you guys had told me you wanted to have it in with the video while he's talking.
Okay,
so.
It's in with the video, yep. When it's talking. Yep. Okay, now what we're going to do, we're going to have someone, we're not going to tell the person's real name. We're going to call him Dr. Doom. And the picture you see in this video will not be the way he looks like. This is going to be a digitally reproduced person. Well, actually, that's a Porky, but we're not going to tell you just exactly his name. A lot of you are going to know him, but we're not going to release his name at large or the exact area of this other serpent mound. But we have a little pre-taped segment here to give a little explanation of some amazing things that we found very near to us, literally an ancient antediluvian worship site. It's just absolutely amazing. But we're going to be talking a lot more about that. We're going to be doing some on-location investigation and filming. It is really something that's very significant. There are things that have been absolutely overlooked or covered up. Take your pick. And they're not a part of the historical register. And when you see the impact of these things, they absolutely should be. But we're going to play this little segment here from Dr. Doom, and you'll get a little introduction here into this serpent mound that is very near the Puritan barn.
It's my grandfather, and some of the stories he would tell, especially to my uncles back in the 70s, he would make a lot of claims, and he would scare him with folklore and whatnot. And he would say things like, "Don't go down there, boys. You know, there's a stone house," or, you know, try to tell them that there's a long haired tall man that's going to get you, and don't go out in the woods out there. Cause the whole association with that is there was a stone house that got destroyed in the 70s. It got vandalized, actually. And what was that about is everything I've looked in the state of Kentucky, as far as mounds, the mounds would always have like a stone house associated with it. And from what I gathered, what I read, some of the explorations as far as the geologists and whatnot would gather around this area back in the early 1900s. And there was a gentleman that looked at these rocks, and so they weren't even native to this location, which was very compelling. And to get back to what I was saying earlier about these so-called legends, and as far as my grandfather making this, I always said to myself, why would my grandfather tell my uncles this? That being said, the particular mounds that we're looking at here, it does, to my knowledge, I've been looking at it for probably about 10 years, and what I've come to the conclusion with, it does resemble a serpent, kind of a protruding out of the ground. It looks like a serpent snake. And this is actually a hinge, but there was one particular right beside it. It was a lot bigger that was associated in that area. That was actually excavated and actually tore down, demolished. I haven't really got a date on that, but it was in the early 1900s. So that being said, you hear all these wild tales about this, especially all the natives, and especially from that area. And just recently, I had a gentleman that was actually taking me. He was a taxi driver. He was an older gentleman, and he was telling about all these things, and we just started associating and started telling these stories, and we started bringing up these mounds. We was talking about mound builders and whatnot. And he actually come out and said, "You're talking about the legends." I was like, "What do you mean legends?" And he was actually saying, yeah, the tall men of large, you know, like a large stature, or he was using these big terms like that, like it was just out of the blue, and the man wasn't even really speaking clear until I brought that point out, and he started quoting off stuff off the tip of his tongue. It was really interesting. I thought it was very compelling. So anyways, he said there's monsters down there. That was the whole tale of the Indian culture and whatnot, and Indian builders and all this. So I thought that was very key to this journey that I went on 10 years ago, which in that time, but this was like 2010, you know, I knew this land. I walked on these lands all my life, you know, went down and visit my grandparents, blah, blah, blah. And you come down to the conclusion, I'm thinking, man, Lord, you brought this to my attention. I've been praying about it, you know, asking the Lord for knowledge, the Holy Spirit to guide me in this and direct me in this, the path to understand this. When they excavate these other mounds in the same county I'm from, they would say this man is dated. He's been, you know, buried for 500 years, you know, and it would be a large stature, you know, type of narrative. They would kind of like always say prehistoric man. Very, very intriguing. It was always saying prehistoric man. Even if you find in your journals and these old journals from particular writers, authors, and Excuse me. So, and another thing that I thought was very interesting is also when I used to be a kid, I used to go all these areas and these lands. I would see, I would just dig up arrowheads, huge arrowheads. And I always said to myself, I said, look, they're scattered across this county in different strategic locations. I said, you know, not only this particular location we're looking to tonight, but I kept saying, there's arrowheads as big as my hand. I was like, there's not this type of game. We don't have game down here that's, you know, buffalo, bear, whatever. I mean, obviously there's a few bears, but I mean, there was significant amount of these. And I thought that was something to take into note, into consideration. Back in the early 1900s, there was a reconnaissance survey, which I had to put this in perspective. I said, okay, a reconnaissance survey, in which I have studied out throughout a couple of things along the way that just kind of stick in my head. I was thinking to myself, you know, reconnaissance survey of a military presence. That's kind of interesting. And then especially when I've done a lot of research into World War I, World War II, and looking into the Hitler narrative, when they would do similar things with, you know, back in Project Paperclip, and then even in his time, as far as America, from what I've read, they would do military bases. If it had like more of a paranormal kind of activity, they look at, you know, newspapers and whatnot and ask different people, villages, cities, you know, they'd be scared of different parts of force. And that's, from my understanding, they would go to these areas that have a higher frequency of, you know, I would always, well, my theory on this is just personally, on these hinges and these mounds, that they actually are have their own frequency. I would say you could use a electric magnetic field reader, and I say it would go off the charts. Even based off the constellations, I know we're getting to astronomy. I think that there is a significant chance that these mounds was strategically laid for constellations. Another thing is, in the area I have looked, in this part of the country, especially in Kentucky, I have looked, and everything I've looked in journals, books, the circumference, they're very symmetrical, very circular, very perfect, our mounds around this area, and especially this county. Probably the best in the world, probably best in the nation is what I've read. And this was past literature, but and there's a very significant, I think if I remember correctly, it was around 71 counties in Kentucky, and we have 120 counties in Kentucky. So that was rich with Indian mounds and giant narrative, if you look in the old newspapers, which was highly just shocking compared to what I've been told around here, especially in today, fast forward in 2021, you look at the Sethite theory and, you know, your Genesis 6 verse 4 narrative, they don't think anything about giants at all around my local area. And that's to do with a lot of dispensationalist beliefs. But that being said, I think even in the 1800s, from what I've gathered, 1800, like mid 1800s, late 1800s, early 1900s, I've even found articles, newspaper articles talking about, literally they'll even come out and say Nephilim and Raphaim. I mean, which that was just bizarre in itself. And I think these places have significant history. Like, anything, I think even the Indian narrative, yes, there was mounds in this county where they picked up sun god worship, because these ancient men that they're saying that's prehistoric and tremendous stature would worship the sun, worship sun god worship. So these Indians would inherit their lives, inherit their religion, if you want to say it that way. But I think even when you look at the excavations I've looked at, especially all throughout the state of Kentucky, they'll say, yes, I pulled out relics. Yes, I pulled out tablets. Yes, I pulled out, 8 to 12 foot tall men. But then they'll change the narrative and kind of shift it and say, yes, but we did find 5'10", 5'8" men, but they would be buried on top or on the sides. And then, to my surprise, it'd be facing their heads. We turned literally facing to, like, you know, if you want to get into summer solstice and winter solstice and all that, but they were literally facing the sun on these strategically laid out mounds, which was very odd. And personally, I think the giants was buried, and then people started worshiping it, you know, in that way, in that matter. And then, you know, years went on, they started burying their families on top of the same mound in some cases. And what I just think it's just something that needs to be talked about, especially in this day and age. And then I have this other theory. Don't hold me to this, everybody. But I always had this theory that if you was to go into a mound and take a compass, just a regular old-fashioned compass, I have this theory that I think even with the magnetic field around them, certain ones, I think it would turn. I have done some study, like a couple of research on one particular one in this county. I didn't have the best of luck because I was actually using I didn't have my compass on me at that moment. I had my cell phone, unfortunately. But then I used an application there, which I don't really believe would be accurate enough. But it did have some anomalies with the cell phone service when I got up to the mound and come back. It was kind of odd. And I started having some data issues. I started getting some emails shifting back and forth and a lot of notifications. So I thought it was kind of strange. But what I have understood on a lot of things is when I look at these mounds, about a 5 to 10 foot radius out, I've noticed that grass does not, you know, tall weeds or anything does not really grow on here. So that was my theory about the connection with the so-called magnetic fields, so to speak. And one other thing too to mention here is there's an army presence in this county. I'm not going to say what army, it's an army depot. What I was astonished by is there's these fortresses and there's different places that was found with these Indian mounds. There's a big fort in south of me and they all are circumferencing like around the army base. But I started looking in some old maps and I actually have the mapping of all the mounds for this particular county and all the other ones that I can, all the 71 that I've found to be accurate from the 1900s, but who knows, they might've found some more about past then, but from what I gather, they've demolished a lot of them, but there's about five or six on the actual army base in the middle, which was highly just, I was thinking, wow, you know, this is, and then I made a connection with that I know this is going to get kind of bizarre, but I noticed a connection with actually the layout of those pyramids had a, when we get into the constellation side part of it, that it would actually, you could just literally, like you just took Orion's constellation and laid it on top of the mound, which would get into the Giza pyramids and whatnot, which I thought was way off the Richter scale when it comes to just, I'm just a man, you know, I'm not nobody, you know, I'm just a man that loves the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm just thankful for the Holy Spirit to give me this knowledge, you know, and I'm thankful to be able to share this with you all. I hope I didn't bore everybody to death. I hope everybody would be intrigued, and especially across the world and any other countries, look around. I mean, look around as far as, you know, if you want to look at mounds or landscaping. I even had a theory that it's probably not really a theory, that I think there's a bunch of pyramids underground in this state of Kentucky. So, and that's just me. Don't hold me to that. But yeah, I think this is all connected to a serpent mound scenario. One, maybe ley lines. I know John and Davis talked about that in the past. I think it's all one big antediluvian, direct connected network of even, well, you know, if you get into the Giza pyramids, back to that, I think that they talk about, you know, radiation, you know, different spikes of different the Giza pyramids heating up at different time frames. In the last couple of years, I think it's 6 or 7 years ago, they started heating back up, and it's almost to a point like, you know, I think South America has had that same they come to the same conclusion. And like I said, I think this is all connected with some kind of intertwining network of systems. And I hope y'all enjoyed what I had to speak about tonight, and I appreciate John and David giving me this opportunity to be on Midnight Ride tonight. And hello to all you NACTV viewers out there, and I appreciate you guys so very much for me to even have this opportunity. And then one more thing, I know all these things can get overwhelming in the world that we're living in, but if we just turn to the Lord Jesus Christ and submit to the one on Golgotha, on Calvary, that shed the blood of the blood of the Lamb to pour upon us and take upon our sins, there's nothing that we cannot do when we're doing everything through Him. And with that being said, I appreciate you guys, and I appreciate everybody that's listening and just letting little old me come on here and speak about these things.
All right. Well, we give away Dr. Doom's name there, didn't we? Well, yeah, yeah. It's Brian. Yeah. But
there's a lot of Brians in the world.
Yeah. Though. So, and of course, Dr. Doom's identity will be fully revealed very soon. But thank you, Dr. Doom, a.k.a. Brian. But Brian was telling us about an ancient fort that is up on a ridge where the history was that this was inhabited by giants. This is the local legend. And that when people would come up there, it wouldn't turn out too well for them. Well, I confirmed the existence of this fort from a PDF from the University of Kentucky way back to the 1800s, that this fort does exist. That's something we're going to be trying to, John's going to do a little drone flying up there and see what we can find that's left of this fort. Now, what's significant about that, in the Ohio Serpent Mound, there's also Fort Ancient. And this fort and this mound, it's in the historical register, very easy to find out information about it. But this ancient fort and this serpent mound is totally off the historical register. And the mound and the hinge and the fort, it is all there. It absolutely is there. It's in an area where there is one of the largest military depots in the country. There are actually mounds inside of the Army Depot on the property there. We've got the everything. There's also documentation of giant bones that have come out of this area that can be documented. We're going to be giving you more documentation in the near future. One of the stories was when the jaw of this giant was dug up, it was so big they were putting on their head like a hat. It was that huge. And what we have going on here, this is a picture of Gilgal Rephaim. This is less than a quarter of a mile from the Serpent Mound of Bashan. And we saw in the picture there with Brian that we have the serpent and the hinge. We see this in Ohio. There's the serpent and there's the hinge. And this is the exact place where Elijah was taken up in a whirlwind to heaven. Now, what I believe happened, and it's a pretty logical conclusion, that when they saw Elijah being taken up into heaven, the Rephaim, they said, oh, portal. And this is literally a Nephilim church. It's a portal. It's where they try to create a portal for these spirits, for them to go in to the third heaven and to bring these spirits down. It's the same thing in witchcraft. They talk about drawing down the moon. And these are portals. This is why we can understand that with these mounds, the hinge, this is a release point. And we could call Gilgal Rephaim here in Israel and the Serpent Mound of Bashan, that's the big daddy right there in the land of Israel. The next largest one we know of is over there in Ohio. And in very close proximity, we have the one here in not far from us. Now, one of the things that we've been thinking about, and we don't have all the answers, we're going to be doing a lot of investigation, but in the commentary on the Book of Jubilees, when Gog was pounding Meshish and Tuval, this was about 15 years after Pangaea. And I believe, and we're working on this, that before Pangaea, these things and these serpent mounds had a very interesting alignment that's going to tell us a lot more about what's going to happen. But literally, the hinge here in Gilgal Rephaim, the one not far from us, these are places when Gog is visited, we're going to see the very return of these spirits from these very locations when we see the restrainer removed. Mm-hmm. Now, we have a picture here, and John, you can give a little description of this hinge. That was near Lexington, Kentucky, and there was another one just like it in Charleston, West Charleston, West Virginia, And it says here, and this is taken from a book by L.A. Marzulli, and it says here that it says the hinges that were 555 feet in circumference. Now, that's all the way around, 555 feet. Now, in Masonic numerology and Kabbalistic numerology, the Washington Monument is exactly 555 feet in height. In the gateway there, you can see that there's a gate opening. The gate is 33 feet wide. Now, 33 is one of the favorite Masonic numbers. And why 33? Why is that opening 33 feet wide? Well, I'll tell you why I believe it's 33 feet wide. Let's read a little scripture. In Joshua chapter 12, now these are the kings of the land which the children of Israel smote and possessed their land on the other side Jordan toward the rising of the sun, from the river Arnon unto Mount Hermon, and all the plain on the east. Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt in Heshbon and ruled from Aor, which is upon the bank of the river Arnon, and from the middle of the river and half of Gilead, even under the river Jabbok, which is the border of the children of Ammon, and from the plain to the sea of Shinnereth on the east, and unto the sea of the plain, even the salt sea on the east, the way to Beth Shemesh, and from the south under Ashiphasaga, and the coast of Og, the king of Bashan. This is exactly where this mound is, the serpent mound of Bashan, which was of the remnant of the giants that dwelt at Ashtaroth and Edrei, and reigned in Mount Hermon, and in Salcah, and in all Bashan, under the border of the Geshurites and the Maacathites, and the half of Gilead, the border of Sihon, king of Heshbon. Now, when the children of Israel were on the east side of Jordan, they kicked the fanny of these two Rephaim kings, Sihon of the Amorites and Og of the king of Bashan. This is ground zero at the base of Mount Hermon, where the 200 came down. And this is where we read in the book of Enoch that they were put into a place of prison, and they are going to be released. We read in Ezekiel 38 that he, Gog, will be visited, and he will return. And going on here, we see in Joshua 12 and 24, and it sums up the story of when they crossed over the Jordan on the west side of the Jordan. It says, and the king of Tisra won, and all the kings 30 and 1. There were two Rephaim kings on the east of the Jordan, Sihon and Og. On the west side of the Jordan, there were 31 kings that were destroyed. All in all, there were 33 Rephaim kings defeated by Joshua when they went in and took the promised land. That's why we see these hinges, a 33-foot gap. They are all about the return of the 33. They have prepared a portal. They have prepared the symbology. This is the ancient worship whereby they are expecting the return of these ancient powers. These sites have been set up all over the earth in anticipation of that moment when this release will take place. This is exactly what is described in Scripture as the removal of the restrainer. There will be a time when the Father tells Michael to stand up and stand still, and when that happens, we're going to see these spirits come back through these portals and these gates that have been prepared, many of them, even before the flood of Noah.
You know, that number 33 comes up so much, you know, and there's so many things that I'm thinking of course, that had to deal with the serpent, such as the serpent coiling up the 33 vertebrae of the spine till it reaches the top. You've got one third of the angels fell. That's equal to 33% of the angels that have fallen. 33rd parallel is where Mount Hermon resides. I mean, there's so many. 33 has so much significance when it comes to some of these things. It's just unreal.
The 33 vertebrae that they raise the Kundalini up into the pineal gland. This is the Masonic number, and this is what it's all about. It's, and what do they call raising the Kundalini? They call it raising the serpent power up the 33 vertebrae of the spine. It's all right here for us, and it's something that, I mean, this is in-your-face stuff. It really is. And in one of the, this is the oldest black magic ritual that is described in Scripture. It's in Job chapter 3 and verse 8. Let them curse it that curse the day who are ready to raise up their mourning. Now, in this text, we're going to understand how that we have inspiration and preservation in the Greek received text and the Hebrew Masoretic text, and also in the English of our King James Bible. Now, this is a commentary on this text from a book, a commentary on the book of Job by Joseph Hartley. And when Job did this, Job absolutely went over the line, and he later repented. Job was in so much pain. Anybody have a lot of pain and ever get in a bad attitude? And Job was in unbelievable anguish, and he sinned, and he later repented. He even got to the point he wished he would die. But, and this is where he's at right now. But this is what the commentary by Mr. Hartley on this text is. It's very, very compelling. He said, to ensure the vitality of his curse, Job importunes the most skilled sorcerers in the ancient world to perform the curse against the day of his birth. These sorcerers are known as those prepared to stir up Leviathan. Now, if you look the word mourning up in Job 3 and 8, it is the Hebrew word Leviathan, ready to raise up Leviathan, translated mourning in the KJV. Now, we're going to show you both levels of revelation there. It says, to stir up Leviathan, the monster that inhabits the sea, and that is the personification of all forces that resist God's rule. Leviathan continually seeks to turn beauty into dust and order into confusion. Whoever possessed the magical arts to arouse him could activate the curses of destruction against anything good and noble. That wizard could even curse a specific day and thus annihilate the existence of one who had been born on that day. That's a little glimpse of what's coming. We're going to see the fruition of this magical working. Now, this is the exposition on the book of Job, and that's quite a commentary on the book of Job, isn't it? And this is by Joseph Carl, the Puritan. And I want to read the comment from Brother Carl on Job 3 and 8, and we'll understand. A lot of people say, oh, you know, the King James Bible's mistranslated. It is not. The way the scriptures are preserved, there is understanding to be gained from studying the Hebrew and the Greek. It never contradicts that what we have in the English. Whenever you find yourself trying to twist the Greek or the Hebrew to contradict the plain meaning of the text in English, you will never come to truth, only to error. But this is the comment by Joseph Carl on Job 3 and 8. First, because those solemn mourners were usually a great many, they were a company, a chorus or a choir making a doleful lamentation. And so when they were to mourn, they called together or raised up their company of mourners. And in the English, we see a real big funeral being planned for. They're literally raising up their funeral. They're raising up the preparations for their own funeral. We see here something that is going to bring in the crescendo of world history. We're talking about things that are going to be in the very time that is called the last half of the 70th week of Daniel, the Great Tribulation, the removal of the restrainer, all of these things coming about into fruition with the rise of Gog from Tartaria, World War III. It's all going to be there, and it's obvious we're seeing this right in front of our eyes, the reuniting of these ancient Tartarian war chiefs. In Amos chapter 8 and verse 10, "And I will turn your feast into mourning and all your songs into lamentation. It is the mark of the finality of awesome judgment, that it is a huge funeral mourning." That's what we see in Job 33 and 8. "And I will bring up sackcloth upon all your loins and baldness upon every head, and I will make it as the mourning of an only son, and the end thereof as a bitter day." In Zechariah chapter 12, we see it here, and we have a specific location, and guess what? It's in the very place where we see this, the serpent mound of Bashan. It says, "In that day there shall be a great mourning in Jerusalem as the mourning of Hadrimmon in the valley of Megiddon. And the land shall mourn, every family apart, the family of the house of David apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Nathan apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Levi apart, and their wives apart, the family of Shimei apart, and their wives apart, all the families that remain, every family apart, and their wives apart." You see, this is what we see, the raising up of the mourning. These are the mourners that are prophetically spoken of in Job 3 and 8. They're going to be raised up when we see the restrainer removed. There's going to be a horrible time coming for those that don't know the Lord. There's going to be a time of trouble when Michael stands down that's never been seen upon this earth. This earth has seen some horrible times, some desperate times, but nothing is going to compare to the rise of Gog from Tartaria, World War III, and the reuniting of these ancient Tartarian war chiefs, the removal of the restrainer. It's going to truly be a time of mourning. And this is spoken of in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. "Alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it." The Israel of God is going to be saved out of it. We're going to be used in this amazing time to spread the good news of the gospel. It's just going to be absolutely amazing. And this is in our face. I mean, this is in our face. We can see this every night that you turn on the news. We hear of Putin building up the Ukraine straight to the north of Israel, on to the east and Tartaria. We now see China and Russia cooperating. Everybody knows the warplanes are buzzing over Shanghai. We see it. And, you know, this is where we're at, John. I mean, it's amazing. And we have so much going on just right in our area that's going to be so spiritually significant. And no doubt that's the very reason that we're in the area that we're at.
Yeah, so true, man. We're in a time like no other that we've experienced, let's put it that way. And the Bible says the time of Jacob's trouble will be like no one's ever experienced. It'll be something such a powerful event in a positive way and a negative way. You know, there's going to be a positive to the whole end when it all says and done. But I agree with you, China, Russia, all of those countries, Ukraine, all of those, I would definitely consider the armies of the North, and there's no way around it. When you talk about Gog and you look at Gog as who he was in the Bible, and you see all the different places mentioned, all the different folklore and different stuff surrounding him, I think there's some books that say that he rode over on the ark with Noah and them. There's all kinds of different weird stuff that goes on about him, but when you actually see him in history and you also see him in in the scriptures, and it lines up with this Tartaria that's being unleashed again for some strange reason for this time period, because it's been so wonderfully hidden for so many years. I mean, me and you both have studied history. That was my favorite subject in school, you know, continually throughout. Tartaria never once grazed any of the history books that I read. And of course, we weren't going back into some of the older books like the, you know, the 1900, early 1900 books. But for a certain period of time, it's non-existent. And here we are now. There's so much significance to all of this, so much significance to the worship of the serpent, you know, the synagogue of Satan, this hidden synagogue that's been going on since the beginning of time, you know. So how easy for them to deceive, you know.
And ground zero of all of this, we've got the medical establishment, the symbol of the AMA, the serpent mm-hmm. on the pole of the ancient god of Acephalus, of the synagogue of Satan. I mean, you miss this at your own peril. This is so plain and so in her face. You got to try to miss it. You just got to be just spiritually dumb and blind not to see what's coming together. I mean, it's amazing. And had we not done, we did, I don't know, about 5 shows on Tartaria, digging it out through old books, encyclopedias. And had we not done that, we could not understand this connection right here, to see the Tartaria connection of this ancient spiritual union between Putin and China. We saw also in one of these Tartaria shows, which are still all up on Now You See TV, how that in the book of Second Esdras, it talks about the kings of the East coming in and reuniting with this area of the Persians for this final move into Israel. These things are just amazing. And some of these key links we've found in the non-canonical books of Enoch, Jubilees, and Second Esdras. And these are things that have enabled us to clarify this with the ancient understanding of our Tartaria, to give us a very profound and a amazingly specific timeline and a purview of that which is coming soon, and that which we're seeing right before our eyes. It's undeniable. It's, to me, it's undeniable.
I agree, man. You know, I was, when you were doing the show, and I remember last week when we were talking about the constellation of of Hercules, and you had referred and said something that some people believe that is actually the represents Samson.
Yes.
And when you look at the tribe of Dan being the serpent in the way, serpent in the path, I believe is how it says. Yeah. And you look at Dan and you see that they were from the coastal cities, and you see some of these Hebrew people that are actually from Dan that mixed with these serpent cultures. Graham Hancock talks a little bit, or not Graham Hancock, but Lawrence Gardner talks a little bit about this mixture of the tribe of Dan in there. Well, after you said that, I was researching that a little bit more, and some people believe that this Hercules is actually the hidden 13th sign of the zodiac, which, if that's true, you know, realize there's 13 tribes of Israel now, you know, when you add the tribe of Dan, which isn't mentioned in the very last time. But is it possible that this 13th sign has to do with tribe of Dan, has everything to do with the serpent?
Yeah.
It's crazy when you really start thinking about it.
And in Revelation 7, the list of the tribes, Dan isn't there.
Yeah.
But he might, because he might be underground.
Yeah.
And Adam Clark's commentary has a large section where he makes the case that the Greek god Hercules is a ripoff and patterned after Samson in the Bible. And it's very compelling that, and of course, the tribe of Dan, many of the early fathers, Irenaeus and Hippolytus, they believed that the beast of Revelation 13 would come from the tribe of Dan, which I'm on board with that. And in the Merovingian kings, one of the marks of the Merovingian kings was their long hair.
Yeah.
They were crazy about their long hair.
Yep.
So here we see, as above, so below, the things that are happening here in the first heaven, they're being controlled by the spiritual powers, both good and bad, in the second heaven, and also under the earth. To understand a comprehensive picture of spiritual warfare, there are things under the earth, there are things in the first heaven, in the second heaven, and the third heaven. The dark world is much more complex than what we would think of just fallen angels and devils. It is much more complex. And the more understanding we have, the more we can become wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove, and the more insight we can have to be able to pray targeted prayers. Because I guarantee you, we're going to see some things that is going to make us hit the deck and call upon the Father. Because I believe the Bible's real. I believe every word in the book of Revelation is true. I believe it all from Genesis 1:1 to the last verse of Revelation. I believe, just like the Word of God tells us, we got an old flat earth. I literally believe it. I literally believe everything in the book of Revelation is going to be fulfilled. And I believe we're on the cusp of it. And it doesn't fill me with fear. It excites me. It's exciting to be alive at this day and this time and be able to speak truth into people's lives that are going to give them an anchor in this time. Already we see people falling apart with, and you know, it's been a lot, but I mean, really, it ain't that much. This whole COVID scamdemic, you know, it ain't all that much, in all honesty. And we're going to see things so much more than that. And people are going to have an anchor for their soul. And this isn't something that everybody's going to get, but there's going to be a people out there that are going to get it. They're going to grab a hold of that rock that will be their anchor in this time of trouble. They're going to not only survive, but they're going to thrive, and they're going to be an instrument for the Father in these last days. And it is absolutely exciting for the Lord to allow us to be a little bitty part of that.
Amen, David. Awesome show. Great job. That was really, really cool to listen to. Usually I talk more, but I couldn't help but just listen to this one. It was really awesome. I know the audience out there really enjoyed it, and you guys were greatly blessed by it. What I'm going to ask you guys to do is, on the count of three, we call this the Pounder's Pound, to smash the like button if you enjoyed this show. And let us know in the comments, let us know what you thought about this and how it's helped you in your studies. Or if you have anything, criticism, give us that as well. We appreciate it. So on the count of three, we're going to hit the like button. We're going to see the likes jump up. We're going to feel it all over the world, because you guys are going to pound the like button. So here we go, David. 1, 2, 3, boom. Thank you guys so much, David. End us out. What an awesome show.
As always, we want to thank each and every one of our Now You See TV listeners for tuning in and listening to the Midnight Ride. We love you very much. We could not do what we do without you. So until next Saturday night, 10 p.m. Central, high five and good night, everybody, from the Midnight Ride.
And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up, rise up, rise up.